So thank you to Zach Lesser for inviting me to speak at this conference, and to John Pollock and Lynn Farrington for all of the terrific organization of today's events. As Michael said, the title of my paper is The Indignity of Sex in Shakespeare's Measure for Measure. When the Supreme Court concluded the 2015 Obergefell versus Hodges hearing with a 5-4 vote to legalize same-sex marriage, the majority in dissent found one striking point of agreement. Kennedy, writing for the majority, along with Roberts, Scalia, Alito, and Thomas, all of whom wrote dissents, were unanimous in their conviction that marriage is characterized by virtue, dignity, and legitimacy, that it has a, quote, transcendent purpose, and that it is inherently desirable and valuable to individuals as well as society. The majority and dissent's disagreement as to the place of marriage in constitutional law stemmed from their divergent views as to the institution's historical purpose. The majority side agreed that the purpose of marriage has always been love. Kennedy celebrates, quote, the beauty of marriage, and claims that the institution, quote, responds to the universal fear that a lonely person might call out only to find no one there, end quote. The dissent insisted that matrimony has always been about not love but procreation. Robert stresses what he calls the vital need for procreation within a legally recognized union, and Alito states that for millennia, marriage was inextricably linked to the one thing that only an opposite sex couple can do, procreate. Definitions of marriage as both a public declaration of love and a pragmatic answer to the need for orderly reproduction of human creatures, indeed, have been present in many societies throughout history, including that with which both sides of Obergefell are most concerned, the European colonization of the Americas and the establishment of the U.S. as a nation. But the general agreement that marriage has always universally been recognized as a sign of virtue and dignity overlooks a key moment in the history of marriage and the history of the English colonization of America, that of the early Protestant Reformation. The Reformation is conventionally understood as elevating conjugal love above lifelong celibacy. In this view, Catholics had distrusted marriage as a sign of attachment to the world, the flesh, and the devil, and seen virginity as an expression of pure, uncompromised faith that set the clergy apart from the laity. By contrast, this story goes, Protestants deemed marriage the highest spiritual state for clergy and laity alike. This narrative of the rise of companionate marriage, however, overlooks not only the availability of a conception of companionate marriage that existed well before the Protestant Reformation, but also the actual writings of influential reformers like Calvin and Luther, as well as the views of many 16th and 17th century English Protestants. The shift between Catholic and Protestant, medieval and early modern, that is, has been overstated. For while Luther, Calvin, and other Reformed theologians did insist on the holiness of clerical as well as lay marriage, their reasoning was more complex and less celebratory than we have supposed. In fact, the claim that marriage may be more conducive to holiness than virginity rests on the conviction that although celibacy remained the spiritual ideal, it was possible only for the chosen few who, singled out for God's special grace, were eunuchs for heaven, free, like Shakespeare's Isabella, from the desire for sex. For the vast majority of humanity, attempts to remain celibate would result only in painful yearning, masturbation, secret fornication, and hypocritical pride before humanity, accompanied by resentment towards God. Marriage, by contrast, for the Protestant reformers, is holy insofar as it constitutes both a personal and public acknowledgement of the humiliating lack of control on which faith and devotion must be grounded. Conjugal sex, in this view, differs from fornication not because it is more rational or innocent, nor because it produces legitimate offspring. Marriage is a sign of holiness because it is a humble acknowledgement of one's innate human depravity and consequent dependence on God's grace, not one's own purity or merit, for salvation. Even within procreative marriage, human sexuality is incapable of achieving the innocence that was possible for our prelapsarian parents, who, as St. Augustine argues, could control their members as voluntarily as their hands and feet, but who fell before... He has all sorts of analogies to contortionists and gymnasts who can do incredible physical feats like wiggle their ears and... So Adam and Eve could, before the fall, could control their members as voluntarily as their hands and feet, but they fell before they had the chance to enjoy the rational and innocent sex of which they were uniquely capable. Because after the fall, the human will became divided and inscrutable. Postlapsarian couples can never be sure whether they are having sex in obedience to God's prelapsarian command to go forth and multiply, or in obedience to their own lustful impulses. And given the time between conception and knowledge of pregnancy, you never know whether a single sex act was actually procreative or not. Accordingly, mainstream Protestant writers followed Paul and Augustine in their agreement that, as Luther put it, although the sin of lust flows beneath the surface of matrimony, marriage is nonetheless acceptable in God's eyes because it, and here's another quote from Luther, it may be likened to a hospital for incurables, which prevents inmates from falling into graver sin. To be sure, he really wrote that. That's just a quote. To be sure, there were many popular pamphlets supporting clerical marriage as part of the institution of Protestantism in England, as well as, and there were lots of writings singing the praises of domesticity more generally. But religious historians have recently begun to argue that their prevalence may be evidence that the populace needed to be convinced that sex could be reconciled with sanctity, rather than a sign of widespread agreement about the innate value of matrimony. Through at least the end of the 16th century, doubt over the spiritual status of sex even within marriage was manifested in the refusal of many English Protestants, including Elizabeth I, to accept communion from married bishops. We get one expression of this ambivalence about marriage in Shakespeare's Measure for Measure. Rather than celebrate marriage, Measure for Measure treats it as a vehicle for public shame and humiliation. The title of Measure for Measure, as we know, derives from the Gospel of Matthew. Judge not that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye mete, it shall be measured to you again. Most obviously, this sentiment addresses the hypocrisy of Angelo, deputy for the Duke of Vienna. Left to enforce long-ignored laws prohibiting fornication and prostitution, Angelo abuses his authority, demanding that the novice nun Isabella, quote, give up her body to sweet uncleanness with him in exchange for the pardon of her brother Claudio, whom, along with his pregnant betrothed Juliet, has been condemned to death for fornication. Amidst multiple substitutions, pardons, and punishments that converge in the play's plot, the Duke engineers a bed trick by which Angelo unwittingly sleeps with his discarded fiancée, Mariana, instead of Isabella. Then the Duke orders Angelo to marry Mariana, orders Lucio to marry a prostitute whose child he has fathered, pardons Claudio and orders him to marry Juliet, and proposes marriage between himself and Isabella. The Duke thereby honors the spirit of the Viennese laws prohibiting fornication by transforming hypocrisy and sin into legitimate matrimony, making honest men and women of his subjects. At least, that would be the Duke's own account of the play's conclusion, along with that of many critics. However, insofar as Angelo is one of the three characters ordered to marry, he is structurally aligned with Lucio, who deems marriage to a quote-unquote punk worse than death and torture, and Claudio, who, quote, got possession of Juliet's bed by making the same true contract in expectation of a dowry that Angelo himself made and broke with Mariana. None of these three unions follow popular early modern representations of marriage as a union that reconciles sex and sanctity, much less one of joyful Christian companionship. The three certain marriages, and I'll talk about the proposed marriage of Isabella and the Duke in a moment, the three certain marriages with which Measure for Measure concludes render interchangeable the sex that takes place within marriage with fornication and whoredom. Notably, all three men who are ordered to marry are also described as having, quote, wronged the women they are compelled to wed. Tellingly, none of these unions are intentionally procreative. The sex is lustful and secret, and Juliet's pregnancy, like Kate Keepdown's, is an accident. Nor are they unquestionably based on mutual love. Mariana's attachment to Angelo is so unrequited as to be humiliating. And although critics have assumed that Claudio and Juliet are in love, and they very well may be, the play includes no explicit description of affection between them, as opposed to carnal desire or attraction. In ordering Angelo, Claudio, and Lucio to marry, the Duke also compels them to recognize the sinful humanity they share with the pimps, perverts, and prostitutes of Vienna. Read in light of biblical, patristic, and 16th century Protestant writings, Measure for Measure insistently de-idealizes marriage, treating it as a public confession of sin rather than a sign of heavenly love or human transcendence. In closing, I want briefly to discuss how attention to the theological resonances of this notorious problem play allows us to appreciate the paradoxical relevance of Christian theology to queer and feminist challenges to the idealization of marriage. Rather than claim that married sex is somehow different and better in kind than fornication, many Christian writers offer a view of human sexuality that resonates remarkably with such foundational insights of queer theory as Leo Bersani's declaration that there is a big secret about sex, most people don't like it, or Michael Warner's observation that perhaps because sex is an occasion for losing control, for merging one's consciousness with the lower orders of animal desire and sensation, for raw confrontations of power and demand, it fills people with aversion and shame. For Warner and for Bersani, a queer confrontation with the aversion that accrues to sex should prompt not a celebratory libertinism, but an ethics of shared humility. In those circles where queerness has been most cultivated, Warner writes, the ground rule is that one doesn't pretend to be above the indignity of sex. Rather, and here's Warner again, a relation to others in these contexts begins in an acknowledgement of all that is most abject and least reputable in oneself, a recognition that if sex is a kind of indignity, then we're all in it together. But whereas Bersani and Warner, along with a host of other influential queer theorists, write in a context in which marriage and monogamy endow sex with normativity and divest it of shame, for patristic and early modern theologians, marriage is to be encouraged because it is a public confession of fallenness, a practice of humility in which one doesn't pretend to be above the indignity of sex. This pretense, as feminists have long argued, not only justifies the persecution of sexual minorities, but also naturalizes sexual coercion and violence. In Measure for Measure, Isabella's proposed marriage to the Duke is a case in point. Much as Angelo demands that Isabella lay down the treasures of her body, the Duke's unanswered proposal is for an exchange of his wealth for Isabella's sexual consent. What's mine is yours, and what's yours is mine, the Duke offers. As a would-be votarist of St. Clair, a Franciscan order distinguished by its rule of extreme poverty, Isabella has been asked to give all she has, her unadorned creaturely body, for worldly accessories that she doesn't want. If we assume the authenticity of Isabella's desire for celibate devotion to Christ, a consecration that Calvin and Luther agreed was the highest spiritual state, one to be honored as long as it was sincere, then the Duke's union with her would constitute a defilement of one of God's chosen eunuchs for heaven. Her submission to the demand for due marital benevolence, not unlike the marital rape that Marjorie Kemp so vividly describes enduring. Critics with a range of ideological investments have questioned the legitimacy of Isabella's refusal of sex with Angelo, and seen the Duke's proposal as a chance for her to return to the fold of civil society, and even the fold of humanity. Such a view is shaped by the gendered and sexual norms voiced by Angelo. "Be that you are," he instructs Isabella, "that is, a woman. If you be more, you're none." We have only to imagine the very different reactions that critics might have to a plot in which it was Claudio's brother, let's call him Isabello, of whom Angelo demanded sexual submission. This counterfactual imagination allows us to appreciate the heteronormative and misogynistic logic of questioning Isabella's choice. Since this is a thought experience, I obviously have no evidence, but my hunch is that critics would sympathize far more with a celibate male character who refused to engage in the supposed crimen contra naturam of sodomy than with a female virgin whose wish not to be penetrated has been deemed as unnatural, has been categorized as unnatural, antisocial, and pathological. That is, equate it with the anal sex that once was categorized in this way, and still is in some quarters. Measure for Measure saw its first performance in 1604, just years before English Protestants made their first attempt to establish a permanent settlement in Jamestown, Virginia. The play turns our attention to a historical and cultural moment that challenges both universalist and idealizing definitions of marriage. For unlike the justices who ruled on Obergefell, the American mainstream they address, or the many Shakespearean critics who take the goodness of marriage and the naturalness of heterosex for granted, the English who funded and participated in the colonization of the Americas were aware of a deeply held suspicion that the sexual impulse could not be sanctified by marriage. It could only be confessed. Engagement with such documents of past ambivalence, resurrecting Shakespeare and Cervantes as philosophers and theorists of gender and sexuality, as well as literary figures who refuse to idealize sex, love, and marriage, can help us to think anew about the sexual values we take for granted, as well as the politics these values so insidiously legitimate. Thank you.
It's my privilege to introduce this final session of this conference on Shakespeare and Cervantes, Roger Chartier and Peter Stallybrass. Roger Chartier is a professor at the Collège de France and the Annenberg Visiting Professor of History at the University of Pennsylvania, and he frequently lectures and teaches in the United States, Spain, Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina, and he has been much honored both here and abroad. And his work in European history is mainly dedicated to the history of education, the history of the book, and the history of reading. He is the author of numerous books, far too many for me to mention today, but I'm going to mention a few. In 2013, The Author's Hand and the Printer's Mind, Transformations of the Written Word in Early Modern Europe. In 2015, he published with Pierre Bourdieu, The Sociologist and the Historian. More recently, he's focused on the relationship between written culture as a whole and literature, particularly theatrical plays for France, England, and Spain. And from this work, he produced the book most relevant to this conference today, Cervantes and Shakespeare, The Story of a Lost Play. And Penn has been so lucky to have Roger as our colleague for so many years now, and his scholarship and his teaching have been critical to our strength in the study of the history of the book. Now, Peter Stallybrass is the Annenberg Professor of Humanities at the University of Pennsylvania, and he's been awarded the Andrew Lang Gold Medal from the University of St. Andrews and 4 teaching awards from Penn. He was the Samuel Wanamaker Fellow with the Globe Theater in London, the Moses Aaron Dropsey Fellow at the Center for Advanced Judaic Studies, and he is a member of the American Philosophical Society. And his collaboration with Anne Rosalind Jones, Renaissance Clothing and Material, was awarded the James Russell Lowell Prize by the MLA. Now, since Roger was appointed to the History Department in 2000, he and Peter have been regularly teaching an undergraduate seminar on reading, writing, and printing. In teaching Hamlet, they discovered the material basis of Hamlet's erasable tables of the mind at the Folger, and they wrote Tables and the Technologies of Writing in Renaissance England with Heather Wolfe and Frank Mowbray. As I'm sure you all know, Peter has provided the phenomenal inspiration, guidance, and energy for the History of the Material Text Seminar here at Penn since 1993, and he co-edits the Material Text series for the University of Texas, and his work and influence in this area are now really the stuff of legend. So we have the great fortune today of having these two partners together to teach us what they know about Shakespeare and Cervantes, and we'll start with Roger speaking of Shakespeare in Spain and Cervantes England, and then Peter on errancy, collaboration, and error, authorship in Cervantes and Shakespeare. So please join me in welcoming Roger.
Thank you, Rebecca.
There is a handout for Roger.
Yeah, there is a handout, as ever. Andy Med. But before I begin, I would like, in the name of all of us, give us a small present to Lynn.
Hold it up.
Between 1605, when a first copy of Don Quixote entered into the Bodleian Library, and the Restoration, England was Don Quixoted, according coined at the time of the Civil Wars. The dense history of the quotations, translations, theatrical adaptations, and political uses of Don Quixote is now well known. It is why today I would like to invert the terms of our interrogation and look not at Cervantes in England, but at Shakespeare in Spain, and also at England in Cervantes' works. The quest for Shakespeare in Spain is quite a quixotic endeavor. His plays, or at least a few of them, translated into Spanish only at the end of the 18th century. Hamlet was the first one to be translated. The first translation was proposed in 1772 by Raon de la Cruz, who used a French adaptation by Ducis, published in 1769, an adaptation itself based on the translation made by Pierre-Antoine de Laplace for the second volume of his Théâtre Anglais, published in 1746. In this case, none of the two translators, Ducis and Ramon de la Cruz, knew English. The second Spanish adaptation, published in 1798, was translated from the English text by Moratin, who had spent the year 1793-94 in London. And we have this the edition of this second translation, 1798, as first to be based on the English text in the exhibition in the Libro. Before the late 18th century, therefore, Shakespeare do not exist in Spanish, but were his plays present in English, in Spain, or in Spanish territories? Only three give an answer to this question. The first one is a copy of the second folios of Shakespeare's comedies, history, and tragedies, published in London in 1632. It was owned by the library of the Real Colegio Seminario de los Ingleses in Valladolid, and it is now in Washington because the volume was bought by the Folger Library in 1928. Founded in 1589 as a St. Albans College, the institution was preparing Catholic missionaries sent in England. The Shakespearean folio was expurgated by a censor licensed by the Holy Office, Guglielmus Sancheius, who was in fact an English Jesuit named William Sankey. He arrived in Spain in 1641 and stayed in Valladolid until 1651, when he moved to another Jesuit college in Madrid. As showed by Brian Cummings in a separate Shakespeare survey, 21 plays out of the 36 in the folio were left without any marking. In 12 plays, the expurgator carefully blacked words or lines conveying oaths, sexual jokes, indecent innuendos, or negative allusion to the priest. 3 plays were more harshly censured than the other one. King John, for the reference to the usurped authority of the Pope, and with the 8th, particularly Cranmer's prophecy and the ending of the play, and Measure for Measure, which was cut out as if was unbearable, both the actions of the Duke impersonating a priest who confessed and gives absolution, and the hypocrisy of the moral control, rigorous censorship of Maurice imposed by Angelo. As observed by Brian Cummings, I quote, the first reader of the Spanish Shakespeare was therefore English, not Spanish. And he adds, while the book may have had Spanish readers at some point, there is no evidence for it. In any case, the Valladolid second folio was the only folio present in Spain if we that nothing confirmed that the Count of Gondomar brought a copy of the first folio in Valladolid. The only copy of the first folio present, if not in Spain, but at least in the countries, belonged to the library of another Jesuit college for English students, the College of Saint-Omer, officially founded in 1594. The city became French with the Treaty of Nijmegen in 1677. This copy of the first word in the Bibliothèque d'Agglomération de Saint-Omer in 2014, and it belonged to the library of the Jesuits, who were expelled in 1763 and replaced by English secular priests. In 17th and 18th centuries, the College of Saint-Omer was famous for its theatrical In 1634, an English visitor, Sir George Shaworth, praised the comedy of the acting of the students. And the library owned a copy of Pericles, mentioned in a book list of 1619, and a copy of the 2 dramatic folios, Johnson's works in the edition of 1640, and Beaumont and Fletcher comedies and tragedies published by Mosley in 1647. 2 data may suggest how Shakespeare was used in Saint-Omer. First, one of the professors, Father Francis Clerc, who was at Saint-Omer between 1650 and 1657, wrote plays for the college. One of them, Innocentia Purpurata, tentatively dated 1654 and devoted to the Wars of Roses, presents so many direct references to 4 Shakespeare that it seems to have been composed using a copy of the folio. But the question is, was the folio already in the college and in the library of the college at this date? It is possible, if it was bought to the college by the sale in the 1630 or by Edward Scrisbrick in the 1660s, but it is not certain. Perhaps the folio entered into the collection only as a part of a donation made in 1736. In this case, we must date as the intense mark-out of the first part of Henry IV. And you have in the handout, I didn't mention it, a reproduction of the last page of Henry VIII in the Valladolid folio, 1632, and the same page page is more easily readable for the Henry IV Saint-Omer first folio. And this marking of the first part of Henry IV was characterized in Saint-Omer not only by the addition of stage direction, but also the blacking of obscenities and profanities, the substitution of hostess by host, along with the separation of all female characters, and many lines of speeches boxed or bracketed for deletion or simply crossed out. It seems that the text was used as a prompt book for performance, or perhaps for performances in parts and recitation of some excerpts. The same can be said of the other play, the only other play, Henry V, that is marked and annotated in the Saint-Omer's folio. Here again, even if Shakespeare was present in a library located in the Spanish territory, he had likely only English readers. This was also the case at the end of the 17th century for a manuscript dating from 1694-95. It contained six Shakespeare's plays, according to their text in the second, three other plays by Lee, Dryden, and Davenport. It doubtless belonged to the English College or Collège des Grands Anglais of Douai. Founded in 1569 for training English priests who were sent to England, the college received children from Catholic families before and after the reunion of the city to the Kingdom of France stipulated by the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle in 1668. As in the Jesuit colleges, plays were performed in this English college, and the manuscript was used for these performances. Of these three books, we have no evidence of reading of Shakespeare in Spanish territories or in Spain during the 17th century. Recently, in an article published in the New Statesman, dedicated to a comparison between Shakespeare and Cervantes, indicated, I quote, "We don't know if they were aware of each other. We can assure him that if Shakespeare knew in a manner or another Don Quixote, as proved by the lost Cardenio, it is clear that Cervantes surely never heard the name of the English playwright. But Cervantes had an idea of England." England is mentioned 17 times in Los Trabajos de Persiles y Sigismunda, published in 1617, 1 year after Cervantes' death, on April 22nd, 1616. Here, an edition sold in Paris in Spanish of the Persiles, 1617. Even if the internal chronology of the novel locates the travels and pilgrimages of the heroes in the mid-16th century, a little after Charles V's death, the conjuncture in which the book was completed and published was characterized by the peace signed between England and Spain in 1604 in London and 1605 in Valladolid. Hence, perhaps in the Persiles, the favorable view of England proposed by Cervantes. In Rutilo's story, chapter 8, first book, "England is a land of commerce." I quote, "During the season of the long day, ships leave those regions, northern countries, for England, France, and Spain with certain kinds of trading goods." A little earlier in the book, Antonio said he was the witness of the peaceful travels between England and Spain. I quote, "I embarked in a ship in Lisbon, had all sails set to leave for England. On board, there were some English gentlemen who, out of curiosity, had come to see Spain, and now, having seen all of it, or at least its major cities, were returning to their homeland." Third example, to Arnaldo, who said, I quote, "It is commonly commented and taken for the truth that bands of wolves, formerly human beings, roam the countryside in England." Mauricio replied, "That cannot be in England, for not only are wolves not found in that such mild and most island, aquella isla templada y fertilísima, But no other harmful animals, such as serpents, vipers, toads, spiders, or scorpions, are either. Of course, in Persiles Irismunda, which ends, as you know, as a pilgrimage to Rome, heresy is condemned. Mauricio declared, I am a Catholic Christian, Cristiano Cattolico, and not one of those beggars who go around looking for the true faith in other people's opinion, mendigando la fe verdadera entre opiniones. But in spite of being heretic, remains, as said Arnaldo, a discreta nation, a sensible nation which is faithful to King Arthur's legend, and I quote, refrains from killing crows throughout the whole island. Cervantes' most English text is, however, the Novela Española Inglesa, published in 1613 as the fourth of the 12 novelas ejemplares, exemplary novel. And we have here two editions of the 1614, one in Pamplona and the other one in Brussels. And I gave some excerpts on page 4, 5, and 6 of the Novela de la Española Inglesa. The starting point, and you have this, of the novel is a rapt of a young Spanish girl during an English raid on Cadiz. Among the prizes, I translate the first line, among the prizes with the England, which the English raiders took away from the city of Cadiz was a little girl of about 7, whom Clotaldo, an English gentleman, and the commander of a squadron of ships took to London. For Cervantes, the operation, as you can see in the following line, was led by the Conde de Leste, Leicester, the Earl of Leicester. This opening of the novel is problematic and can be understood either as a result of a confusion by Cervantes or as the expression to depart from historical reality. Indeed, if Cadiz was really sacked by the English in 1596, it was by Essex. And if Leicester won with Drake a battle against the Spaniards in the harbor of Cadiz in 1587, and Leicester did not enter into the city. Clotaldo and his family share the same faith than the parents of the students of the colleges in Salamanca, Saint-Omé, or Douai. I quote, and I have indicated in the text, all the members of Clotaldo's household were secret Catholics, although in public they appeared to adhere to the religious views of their queen. This condition of conversos or moriscos turned upside down produces permanent anxiety and the fear to be discovered and denounced. When the queen asked Clotaldo to bring Isabella, the young lady raptured in Cadiz, to the palace because the consent of the queen was necessary for a marriage with Clotaldo's son, Ricaredo, Clotaldo's wife, Lady Kathryn, is very afraid. I quote, alas, what if the queen knows that I have brought up the girl as a Catholic, a la Cattolica, so deduces that we are all Catholics in this household. And when the lady-in-waiting of the queen, who tried to kill Isabella with poison because she failed to marry her to her own son, Ernesto, when this lady-in-waiting is arrested to a prison, a dungeon, I quote, she defended her action by saying that by killing Isabella, she was making a sacrifice to heaven by ridding the earth of a Catholic. But in the novella, Queen Elizabeth does not shed at all this violent Catholicism. She is respectful of Isabella's belief and admires the young lady for her perseverance. To her lady-in-waiting who denounced Isabella before being arrested as tan Christiana, so devout that nothing was able to turn her face, the queen replied that she estimated her the more for it, precisely because she had held to the faith her parents had taught her. This tolerant Elizabeth is perhaps a direct effect of the peace. 1604, if, as some editors think, Cervantes writes the text just after this date and not earlier, as other editors are thinking. She could be also, this tolerant Elizabeth, the expression of a fundamental characteristic of many works of the Golden Age that could not attribute to foreign sovereigns heretic affirmations, even if it was for condemning such opinions. It is the reason why the English kings and queens, beginning with Henry VIII, speak often reign of their own beliefs in Spanish printed text or on the stages of the Corrales. The secret faith of the English Catholics and the public adherence to the Church of England required repentance and absolution. It is why Ricaredo, after he promised to Isabella to be her husband, it's the reason why he went to Rome. I quote, where he said, "My soul rejoiced and my faith was strengthened. I paid homage to His Holiness the Pope. I confessed my sins with the Church who absolved me and gave me the necessary documents to prove my confession, penitence, and reintegration into our Holy Mother, the Church." La reducción a nuestra universal madre, la Iglesia. The word reducción is a word used for the conversos reconciled, reunited with the Catholic Church. If Isabella became Inglesa, England in Cervantes' novel is already Española. When Isabel met the Queen, she spoke to her in English. The Queen replied, "Speak to me in Spanish, child, for I understand it, le entiende bien, and I shall take pleasure in speaking it." After the Queen agreed to the marriage between Isabella and Ricaredo, under the condition Ricaredo showed his valor at her service, the Queen said that she claims her, Isabella, as if she were her own daughter. Isabella, listening to this, knelt down before the Queen, and for pleasing her, she spoke to her in Spanish. As many of her subjects, Elizabeth understands Spanish, but she does not speak it very fluently. When she meets Isabella's parents, the young girl is a necessary translator, interpreter of the conversation. Ricaredo also knows Spanish, but declared that, I quote, "he did not speak it very well." In any case, Cervantes echoes here the knowledge of Castilian language among the social and intellectual elites of early modern England. The paradox of the novel comes from the fact that valorous and generous Ricaredo is sent by Queen Elizabeth to go privateering, partirse en corso, a courser who must capture Spanish and Portuguese ships returning from Western or Eastern Indies, loaded with gold, pearls, diamonds, and spices. Hence his dilemma, I quote, "the inclination of his religion forbade him to draw the word against Catholics. And if he did not draw the word, he would reveal himself either as a Catholic or a coward." Near the Straits of Gibraltar, Ricaredo captured two Turkish galleys, frees the Christian slaves, and also 20 Turks in order to hide his love towards Catholic prisoners, and back to England with a ship from Portuguese India full of pearls and spices previously captured by the corsair Arnaote Mami. The presence of England in the novela de la Española Inglesa cannot be separated from three Cervantine geographies. The first one is the geography of Christendom. Like in the Trabajo de Persiles y Sigismunda, Rome is a locus of authority, of sacrality, not only because it is only in Rome that English Catholics, hiding their faith, receive forgiveness an absolution, but also because the lives of the lovers, Ricaredo and Isabella, and their families, are located within the tension between two Catholic theological definitions. The traditional of this definition locates the sacrament of marriage in the exchanges of vows and promises. The second one, established by the Council of Trent, supposed a religious ritual, the public exchange of consents by groups and the consecration of their union by a priest. Like Cardenio and Lucinda in Don Quixote, Ricaredo and Isabella, who exchange vows, are married esposos before the celebration of their wedding. The second geography of the capture and ransoms in the Mediterranean Sea. Ricaredo himself was captured by Turkish pirates when he was coming back from Rome at the place they called, I quote, Les Trois Maries on the coast of France. Sent to Algiers, he is ransomed by the Fasmid, although he was a foreigner. He came back to Spain with 50 other ransom captives and marched the traditional redemption procession in Valencia. Wearing the smoke of the prisoner ransomed by the father of the Order of Trinity, he went to Seville, where he arrived to prevent Isabella, who believed that he was dead, to enter as a nun into the convent of Santa Paula. As Ruiz Perez de Viedma, the captive escaped from Algiers in Don Quixote, Ricaredo is an imagined double, resembling yet different from Cervantes himself. Cervantes was a prisoner who was captured by Turkish corsairs when he was returning to Spain in 1575, who was prisoner in Algiers, but during 5 years and a half, and not only 1 year as was Ricaredo, and who also regained his liberty after being ransomed by the father of the Holy Trinity. A third geography, as the last one, in the Española Inglesa, perhaps less expected, is a commercial one. As observed by Harry Sieber for his edition of First Novelas Ejemplares, the text describes with an extreme the financial mechanisms that allow the Queen, Elizabeth I, to send money to Isabella and her parents when they left London for Seville, where the young lady will wait for Ricaredo su esposo. I quote, and you have the text. The Queen sent for a rich man who lived in London, a Frenchman, who had contact in France, Italy, and Spain, and gave him 10,000 crowns, asking him for letters of credit, cédulas, to transfer them to Isabella's father in Seville or some other place in Spain. The French merchant explained how he will proceed with in Seville. I quote, and you have this, he would write to Paris so that the letters could be made out there by another correspondent of his, and so the letters would be dated from France and not from England, because contact between the two countries, England and Spain, was forbidden, and it would be sufficient to take an undated letter with certain signs from him for the Seville merchant to hand over the money, since he would have received notice from Paris. The authorizing letter, Carta de Aviso, arrived in Seville, and I quote, the French merchant handed the 10,000 crowns to Isabella's and her parents. This mechanism is meticulously repeated when Ricaredo in Rome, I quote, gave 1,600 crowns to a banker who transformed them via a Florentine banker named Rocchi to the city of Seville. Why such an insistence on these financial details, which are necessary for the story, for producing reality-like effects, effet de réel, as an echo of Cervantes' knowledge and experience as tax collector and provider for wheat and oil for the armies between 1587 and, or as suggested by our receiver, for intertwining love and economy. Or better said, to propose an economia dell'amor that associates the ideal, threatened love proper to the sentimental Hellenistic romance, shared by los trabajos de Persiles y Sigismunda and the novela de la Española Inglesa, to associate this ideal love with the prosaic material reality of everyday life that were the fabric of the history of Don Quixote. England was for Cervantes a possible partner when peace allowed travels and exchanges, but it remained a country in which the true faith was ignored and the true Christian, the verdaderos católico-cristianos, were persecuted. Anthony Burgess, who wrote a bitter dialogue between Cervantes and Shakespeare in his short story Meeting in Valladolid, is perhaps right. Nothing allows us to think that Cervantes would have been delighted to meet heretic Englishmen.
So let me begin by thanking Lynn Farrington and John Pollock and Laura Adelot and the whole sixth floor staff. I mean, this none of this would have been possible without them. They've made possible not only this conference, but all the teaching that Roger and I have been doing together over the years. It's really been made possible by the sixth floor staff. And it's been just a wonderful place to be. It's, you know, it's our natural home. So thank you. I'm simplifying. The whole title is Shakespeare, Cervantes, and Authorship. Okay, so that's what it's going to be about. And mainly what I'm doing is ripping off both colleagues and former colleagues. So the people I'm mainly ripping off are Margareta de Grazia, Zachary Letter, but John Pollock, but above all, Roger Chartier. And I just wanted to say that Roger has been just a wonderful, wonderful, it's been wonderful working with him over these years. It's such a privilege to have him here at Penn. And he's just an endless source of inspiration. So thank you, Roger. So I want to start with the authoring and unauthoring of Shakespeare. And particularly what I'm thinking is different models we might have to think about Shakespearean authorship before I come back to Cervantes and authorship. Probably the most important recent book thinking about the whole of Shakespearean authorship, but above all as a literary author, has been Lucas Ernes, Shakespeare's literary dramatist, is to take Hamlet as the very privileged case and gives this as a model. So I'm not going to say anything about that. It's just to say, if you start with Hamlet, you can do all sorts of interesting things, and I think it's an interesting book. In the 19th century, in many ways, The Tempest was crucial for thinking about the whole arc of Shakespeare's career with the conclusion. And this, above all, is the work, I'll come back to that, of Ernest Dowson, a great Irish critic, who said explicitly that he says The Tempest is unequivocally autobiographical. So it's unequivocally autobiographical. It is Shakespeare's farewell to the stage. And so that's the way he reads it. What I want to propose is an alternative model, which is actually Shakespeare's most popular play, written in the 17th century. In other words, if you want to say what play of Shakespeare's was most reprinted in the 17th century, the answer is Pericles. Far more popular than the other one. Hamlet is the closest rival to it. Always his 16th century plays, Henry IV, Part I, above all, that's far and away his most popular play. The second two most popular plays, Richard III, Richard II, in terms of print. But my notion is conflict radically, and this comes out of work that Zach and I have been doing, with this notion of the tempest as Shakespeare's farewell to the stage. In the view of Zach and I, Shakespeare begins a new career in 1608 by returning to collaboration. And he returns to collaboration because there's one kind of play he's not written before, which is romance, tragic comedy. He hasn't really written, I mean, the nearest you get are things like Measure for Measure would be very interesting to think about it in relationship to this. But I think that he hasn't written this kind of play before, and so he needs to learn how to do it. And what he does, far from sort of retiring to Stratford, he starts working with two playwrights. The first is, one is a novelist, George Wilkins. And George Wilkins is an expert on romance. And this is the guy here. And in 1608, the year before we have the printed Pericles, we have The Painful Adventures of Pericles, Prince of Tyre. There's no author given. It's by George Wilkins. And
the oddity about it is described here, the true history of the play of Pericles, as it was lately presented by the worthy and ancient poet John Gower. Right? So it's a play, but it's a play presented by a medieval poet. John Gower is the medieval poet, that's him there. So, and that actually is the play as we have it. It's a play which actually is by John Gower. So the question of authorship doesn't really arise except as a medieval past. So it rises as a medieval past. This is the guy you need to attribute it to. It is a play, it has been presented. And when Gower, George Wilkins, sorry, goes on, he does the argument of history, in my view, well, I say my view, actually, Tiffany Stern has argued that this is a four-page summary of the whole plot, and she argues, I think, totally convincingly, that this is actually the plot of the play. People didn't write plays before the companies approved them, and what they did is they read out aloud to companies a four-page plot, 2 to 4 pages, very few survive, but this may indeed be one of them. So the argument of the history is actually probably, in Tiffany Stern's view and in mine, the actual plot that Wilkins made. In other words, that Shakespeare is following Wilkins' plot. Shakespeare didn't write the plot of this play at all. The play was plotted by George Wilkinson, who wrote probably the first three acts, and Shakespeare adds on the second two acts. He's learning how to write this new genre, and he'll go on to write with John Fletcher, the two noble kinsmen, amongst other plays. I think he also collaborated with him on other things. And all I want to say about the end of this, so this is the actual sort of plot of the whole play, but it ends only entreating the reader to receive this history in the same manner as it was under the habit of ancient Gower, the famous English poet, by the King's Majesty's players excellently presented. Right, so again, we have this emphasis upon the play, but a play and a company, but insofar as you want to attribute it to anyone, you attribute it to the plot maker, the original plot, which is John Gower. So John Gower is the author of the play. When it was actually printed, it is true, it is printed as by William Shakespeare. So the late and much admired play, and now you do get William Shakespeare, and I take that to be, you know, different ways in which you might market something. So there are different ways of marking. It's not particularly striking. But it's not his, Shakespeare's name appears nowhere in George Wilkinson's anonymous, apart from John Gower. So you've got already two models of authorship. But this is Pericles in print, entered 1908, and then reprinted six times before the Restoration. It's the most reprinted of Shakespeare's post-1600 plays. So this play that very few of us read, I think it's a wonderful play, I think it's a great performance play. Annie saw it at Ashland, so fabulous there. I think it's one of the most moving plays, but that's, I think it's a spectacular play. What we know about it, it was massively popular. This is a description of an anonymous pamphlet that's about going into a pub. So you go to a pub, and what's the pub like? It says, amazed I stood to see a crowd of civil throats stretched out so loud, as at a new play, all the rooms did gentles mixed with rooms, so that I truly thought all these came to see Shaw or Pericles. Right? In other words, this is, it's a huge mixture of people. What are they coming to see? They're coming to a great pub, and the pub is as good as Shaw or Pericles. It's why you might go to the theatre, have a really good time. Now that wasn't the view, what's happening here, what's there? That wasn't the view of Ben Jonson. So Ben Jonson, after the flop of his play The New End, writes the just indignation the author took at the vulgar censure of his play by some malicious spectators begat this following to himself. And so this is Ben Jonson writing to himself, and this is a passage quoting him. No doubt some mouldy tale like Pericles, and stale as the shrieve's crusts, and nasty as his fish scraps out every dish, thrown forth and raked into the common tub, may keep up the club. Their sweepings do as well as the best ordered meal, for who the relish of these guests will fit, need set them but the alms basket of wit. So this is Jonson contrasting himself. The point I want to make, though, is that what Shakespeare is doing here is doing something connected
connected, I think, to Don Quixote. Namely, he's going back in time to a medieval past, to the chivalric past. He's returning to older tales, moldy tales, right? Moldy tales of chivalry. It's a play that has enchantments in it. It has tournaments in it. It has armor. One of my favorite things is the rusty armor, which connects it. And the rusty armor, in my view, specifically, we know that Shakespeare's company had armor, literally owned armor, because Hamlet's ghost walks in armor. And in my view, I like to think it's the same suit of armor a bit later that's rusty. And now I say you have to put on rusty armor. So it's actually got a kind of nice feel to it about the actual aging process, you might say, the aging process going on. So, my notion then is that the popularity of Pericles is actually constituted around the very things that Johnson hates, that it's a hodgepodge, that it's a mixture of things, it's scraps put together, it's all of these things, and that's what makes it so fabulous. And that's really what Tiffany Stern has been arguing in a lot of her work, that these words that we use negatively are actually a good description of these plays. They're hodgepodges, this kind of notion, particularly coming from stews, food that you get lots of different ingredients all together. I think it's great, and I think it's exactly what Shakespeare's up to. And I want to say that this is opposed to, in my view, what will emerge in 1623, the first folio, which excludes Pericles. And now we do have, in all his primacy, Master William Shakespeare. So we get Shakespeare, but we get a Shakespeare without Pericles. And from this point onwards, there's going to be, this is a massive reduction into 2 minutes of what should take 2 hours. What I would say is you get the beginning of a process which will end up in the 18th century with the absorption even of Shakespeare's characters back into Shakespeare himself. There are two ways in which this was done. The first, Margaret de Graz has written a lot about this. The first is the tradition of what are called the beauties of Shakespeare. And the beauties of Shakespeare get rid of the characters altogether. You forget who said anything. It doesn't matter who said it, whether Polonius said it, whether Iago said it. They're said by Shakespeare. That's what the beauties of Shakespeare are. These are books of selections, selected passages, said in Shakespeare's voice. So you take the plays and produce them as basically what Shakespeare himself did. The second thing, which is much subtler and in some ways a much more interesting process to my view, is the dating of Shakespeare's plays. And that what Margaret Graci has shown is that the dating of Shakespeare's plays, which is completely speculative, we don't know the dates of most of them, we know when they were printed, we don't know when they were written. So the dating of the writing of Shakespeare's plays is a kind of invention of Edmund Malone at the end of the century, where he tries to put them in a sequence which will give you, through the plays themselves, the biography of Shakespeare. So as you read through, instead of starting with The Tempest, which is the first play printed in the first folio, you will end with The Tempest. You need to have an arc, and the arc is going to give you the arc of Shakespeare as a writer. And that's going to become more and more important in the 19th century, particularly, as I mentioned before, with Edward Dowson, who really wants to use the plays themselves as the autobiography of Shakespeare. So you're taking the first folio, the image, but now you're doing something completely different. Instead of dividing them by genres, dividing the plays up by genres, you're thinking of them as the biography of Shakespeare, culminating, as the plays do for Ernest Dowson, with The Tempest. And above all, the famous speech in The Tempest by Prospero, "Our revels now are ended. These our actors, as I foretold you, are all spirits, and are melted into air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherits shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life with a sleep." Well, it's a magnificent narrative, but it's just all wrong in my view. The play's wonderful and the speech is wonderful, but taking this as the sort of climax, as I say, I think what you've got is the opposite. You've got Shakespeare actually, at the end of his life, starting this whole new career in tragic comedy and really experimenting, going back to collaboration. So, nonetheless, the long consequences of what I'm showing in the 18th century, I'm arguing, is the undoing of collaboration, the expulsion of all these plays that are thought to be not worthy of him. It was added in, so here you get these added, but they disappear, most of these plays, again afterwards.
So famously, the Bodleian Library threw out their first folio when they got the third folio because it had more plays in it. So you get rid of the old version and put it in, and then they had to buy it back at great cost. So they bought a new first folio in the 20th century for vast sums of money. So what I want to say then is the stripping away of collaboration is this whole process to discover the true Shakespeare, and from the beauties of Shakespeare to the dating of the plays to Shakespeare's farewell to the theatre. But if we move now to the authoring and unauthoring and reauthoring of Cervantes, we find actually something, I think, remarkably different in many ways. First of all, of course, there's the authoring within Don Quixote itself. There are several different kinds of authorship that he plays with. I mean, these are only some of them. You can find many more if you want to. But you can start with Cervantes, who describes himself as the stepfather in the prologue. And then in the prologue for the second part, he says that the second part has been cut by the same craftsman's hand as the first part. That I think there's actually a kind of hardening of authorship, you might say, in part two, for a very obvious reason, which this guy here, Avellaneda, had done a fake continuation, or in fact, a real continuation. He continued Don Quixote. And so when the second part comes out from Cervantes himself, which is a year later, he actually begins a furious tirade against Avellaneda and the notion that Avellaneda got it all wrong and didn't understand where Don Quixote went to, and Don Quixote changed his mind, and so you get a whole series of remapping. Then you get the second author, is the authors who have related this most true story, a generic notion of annals, a whole series of things out of which you construct. Then, most famously of all, Sidi Hemete Berengeli, the Arabian historian, who keeps reappearing as the actual person who wrote it, that has to be translated from Arabic. So you've actually got this notion that the whole of Don Quixote is translated from Arabic into Spanish. And finally, and this is really what I want to concentrate on, is Don Quixote himself as the author of Don Quixote. Because in my view, that's actually going to become the emergent paradigm, above all in England. So Cervantes as author, it's not that people don't know. Everybody wants to know those things, that Cervantes is the author of it. There's no secret about it. It says, so this is two editions we have here at Penn, they're not the earliest editions. But again, you've got the notion of who's the author. Even more prominently, outside Don Quixote, here. So this Historia, this is Persile e Sigismondo. And then in England, specifically excluding Don Quixote, you get perfect attention to the authorship of Cervantes, by Miguel de Cervantes, one of the prime wits of Spain for his rare fancies and witty inventions. Or here, delight in several shapes by the elegant pen of that famous Spaniard, Don Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra, the same that wrote Don Quixote, not rendered into English. This is the same book, it's just that that's an engraved title page, so this is the printed title page, so again, just the same thing again, by the famous Spaniard, Don Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra, the same that wrote Don Quixote. But, so, there's plenty of this kind of thing, but Don Quixote, what's remarkable about it, is how, by and large, Cervantes goes missing. The history, this is 1612, Shelton's translation, the history of the valorous and witty knight Errant Don Quixote of the Mancha, translated out of Spanish. No mention of Cervantes. An image which we saw before in Sarah's paper, which actually is from, is this right, Roger? It's from 1618, a French, it's taken over from a French edition. Because you can only have the first part, it was attached to the 1612. So some unsold copies get this attached to it. So it shows you how images migrate, and it's a point of factor. So this is migrating from post-1618 to a 1612 copy. And you can't have a first part till after 1615, right? This is 1612, because there was no second part until 1615. So you can only call it the first part after that. And you can also see the French influence by the actual spelling, Don Quixote. So what you have, though, and what's interesting about this is not only are you getting rid of, you're not naming Cervantes on the title page, you're beginning to actually get the crucial figures of Sancho and above all, Don Quixote himself, and the windmill as well, which will become kind of a stand-in for the whole book. When you actually look at the prefatory material, this is part of the joke of Cervantes. How do you start writing prefatory material? How should you start? You should write by having all these prefatory poems. And of course, prefatory poems are normally written to the author. That's the whole point of prefatory poems. Who are these written to? Written to Don Quixote, right? And who are they? It's the Don Quixote who's living in contemporary times. It's actually being written to by the past, right? The past, Don Quixote precedes all these people. Amadis de Gaulle is already out there thinking, who should I write to? I must write to Don Quixote. So you actually reverse the whole of history. So the whole of history is reversed, but the central character then is that the character is taking over the book. So Orlando, Cervantes himself initiates this move. Orlando Furioso is all writing, and you know, Roger and my's favorite is that El Cid's horse. Writes a dialogue. There's a dialogue of El Cid's horse with Don Quixote. The horses actually have this little dialogue together about how they. So that's a sort of, you know, this is. But the whole point is it's all being organized around Don Quixote as the author and addressee, not around. Compare it with Shakespeare. So the Shakespeare prefatory material is to the memory of my beloved, the author, Master William Shakespeare, and what he has left us. And this is Diggs to the memory of the deceased author, Master William Shakespeare. And this is Holland upon the lines and life of the famous Scenic poet, Master William Shakespeare. So a radical contrast between the way the prefatory material is being organized, which starts with Cervantes himself. And then, nonetheless, this is the 1620, the second part of the history by Shelton. Now you do get Cervantes, but that's just about unique. When we get to 1651, no mention of Cervantes. 1687, no mention of Cervantes. So Don Quixote as author is also going along, of course, with the whole visual tradition, a massive visual tradition that's already well established in this sense by the notion contrasts with the first folio. Think of the first folio with Shakespeare's face, second folio, Shakespeare's face, third folio, Shakespeare's face, fourth folio, Shakespeare's face. No Cervantes' face. Cervantes' face does not appear. We're not getting it. What we get is endless recyclings. The windmill, is a repeated game, no claim to this being Cervantes. It's not as I say that people don't know. My point is not that people don't know it's Cervantes. It's not important. That's not what's interesting. What's interesting is to see this as a sort of self-reflexive thing in which the equivalent in England is Robinson Crusoe. Robinson Crusoe is always the author of Robinson Crusoe. There's always an author portrait of him. So when does he start to be constructed as an author? And the answer is surprisingly late, and in England. So the first author portrait we have, this I didn't understand, so Roger explained it to me. I just thought this, I didn't have no idea what this was. But it is actually an allegorical portrait of Cervantes entering into Parnassus. So this is Parnassus here, and this is an allegorical figure, and these are the muses surrounding him and sort of celebrating on his way. So we have the allegorical author, and that's literally opposite the title page. And you can see, although it's in Italian, it's printed in London, like Mondo. So it's in Spanish, but printed. And what do we get then? We get a biography. This is the crucial thing we already have for Shakespeare by this point. The notion of you need to have a biography. And what do you need to accompany a biography? You need an author portrait. But the author portrait is already complicated, because the author portrait is... he's writing, but this is his armor here. This is Cervantes' armor. And then outside is Don Quixote. In other words, they meet around the armor. The armor, by the way, Quixote's means a piece of armor thighs. It's thigh. So Quixote's, you can see it in the dictionary outside, the 1599 Percival Dictionary. Quixote's means the thigh arm. So the notion itself gives you not those pieces specifically, but the thigh armor here. So there's a kind of, you do get the author portrait, but again, the date, 1738 in England. How do you know this is Cervantes? We know because he actually, in part two, there's the stump of his hand. It's an amazing picture, this, because it's all concealed. and yet the shadow is on his writing hand, and the light falls on this really gruesome, looking like a piece of ham or something, you know, the notion of his other hand. And I'm just about finished, so. But even here, once you actually get to the beginning, this is all the same book, right? So we're looking, first of all, allegorical author, secondly, Cervantes. But then when we actually begin the novel, we have another author portrait. It's Don Quixote as author. And he's doing the same thing. He's looking up at the armor, just as we can see. So the armor is there. And what's he doing? Again, he's surrounded by books, just as Cervantes is. So Cervantes is surrounded by books. He's got, those are all books in the background. And here, you know, there's the library, all of these books. So he's reading, you know, and again, ways a picture being printed in England taken from the kind of idealized notion of the inspired poet of which Shakespeare was the person par excellence. In other words, so you've got basically Cervantes being rewritten through the image of Shakespeare and through the image of a specifically inspired Shakespeare. And this wild look, this is the notion of Shakespeare's native woodnotes wild. That was said by Milton. Shakespeare's native. And Cervantes, they meet with these native woodnotes wild. So you can see in a way the move. This is a rather too sedate portrait by the 1738 that looks like more like the inspired poet. So what will happen is that very rapidly this notion of the Cervantes as author will get picked up. Wonderful view of the stump. And then for reasons I don't know, that clearly this image comes afterward. I think what we're looking at here is this image, I would suggest, is probably done about 1730. So the engraving must be done about 1730 and then reprinted many times. But undoubtedly, as I'm sure, it started without a hand. He gets a hand here. So in Belgium in 1739, this is bizarre, since he specifically begins part two by talking about the fact that he's maimed and doesn't have a hand, right? So he actually says that in part two of Don Quixote. So the very notion of giving him the hand back, but actually if you look closely, you can see it's been added on. The stump is there, and then it's been engraved, and that's why it's such a weird... If you go back, you've got such a big distance, so it's got to fall down to the top of the... So you actually have a sort of gruesome, sort of rather dead-looking hand dropping down. And so I'm going to leave you with that, because I've got nothing to say about that. I'm going to leave you with the dead hand. And that makes it... Dead hand is the only sort of giveaway that you're dealing... I mean, otherwise, we'd have no idea that this is Cervantes. We don't know what Cervantes is. So this kind of invention of a Cervantes, we don't really, of course, know what Shakespeare looked like, apart from the first folio. So the first folio gives us our model. What I'm saying here, though, is we get, how do we know this is, well, we know this guy's Spanish. How do you all know he's Spanish? Exactly. It's that, you know, we all know this is a cliche in England, that all Spanish, you can see from Antonio, he should have a moustache like this, turned up. You know, the notion of the turned up moustache, all Spaniards. And the nose, that's right. The nose, and you put those two together, and you've got, the argument I'm trying to make then is that there is this sort of construction, finally, in the Romantic, you know, in the, well, pre-Romantic, in the early, the middle of the 18th century, of Cervantes, but very much a back formation, dependent in many ways upon Shakespeare, not just Shakespeare, there are many other author portraits there behind, but extraordinarily late.
We have time for just a couple of questions because we need to keep the schedule. So questions or comments from...
Okay,
there? Yeah? Okay. Oh.
He indicated me, but it's okay.
Okay, well, we'll go with Anthony on there. Okay.
I wonder, Peter, thank you. In the creation of this image, my young sister Carlos, they published their biography. What it has to do with the creation of this image of Cervantes in England? Do you know?
I have no idea.
The guy is a very important guy. The beginning of the creation. Yes. The Parnassus of the, you know, the great men in all those things.
So
I wonder if it has to do with
I mean, Roger would know much more about that than I do. I mean, I just, you know, literally, Roger pointed this out to me, I should say that. So it's Roger. These ones are all here, by the way, at Penn, so I just went through our collection and, you know, looked at. So these sorts of images, this one on the left is printed in The Hague, and the one on the right is printed in London. So you get a sort of, you know, I mean, I think once you've got that first breakthrough, which is, first of all, you decide to print the biography at the beginning of his works, and that you already have this illustrated tradition, because Don Quixote is, I'd say, almost the majority of editions, not necessarily heavily illustrated. If they're not illustrated, what you find, we have a copy here from 1687, they've added in illustrations from the 18th century. So it's as if you feel it's not really right, the book, unless you've got a picture, particularly the windmill. You don't need lots of illustrations, you need a few. You need to have Sancho being tossed in the blanket, you know, so that. So there's three or four, and they are the images, by and large, that most people know Don Quixote by. But I think that this particular one, I do think it's the inclusion of the biography that's the clue to the. But then what's interesting is it's the addition of the first time you get a real author portrait of Don Quixote too. In other words, as if even when you've constructed Cervantes, it's not enough. You actually need now to construct, you know, Don Quixote himself as an author. And he looks so much more inspired. I mean, it's a rather dull picture, to be honest about it, of Cervantes, whereas the one of Don Quixote is fabulous. You know, he's looking up, he's looking inspired. Roger, do you want to...
Okay, Roger, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go with the question.
My kind of rough framework for understanding Cervantes across the centuries is that 18th century Quixote was still understood more in a burlesque way,
Yes, I do. I mean, I think very rapidly. I think the 1738 is a very deluxe edition. It's a serious edition with, you know, it's a large format, new engravings, the quality, everything about it. It's in, I think, five volumes, is that?
Four
volumes, is it? So four volumes. So it's a multi-volume work. So it's expensive. It's really meant to be, you know, a major statement. And the fact it's being printed in Spanish, too, so it's being printed in London, but in Spanish, it's for people who actually, you know, are going to learn Spanish, going to be like Freud, you know, if you go back to that, you know, like Freud, learn Spanish to read him. But very rapidly, you get these images, which clearly develop out of that other image. So, that, I mean, I could show that in more detail. I should say to begin with that the author portrait is earlier than that edition. So in other words, I think that they were engraved by Virtue, who's a very famous engraver, and they are dated, and they're dated, I think, 1728, so literally 10 years earlier than that edition. So I presume as separate engravings, and then actually come together in the book. So I think there's some, but once they come together in that book, then you're going to get lots of copies made, and it's going to become very common in all sorts of Cervantes books to have an author portrait.
Can we have time for one more question? Yes, over there.
Yes. I hope I can ask two questions at the same time. I'm curious, is there any analog to established playwright who primarily from editions of things who later becomes a collaborator among any of the other playwrights?
Oh, interesting.
And my other question is, I'm curious how Cardenio factors into this whole story, you know, that play.
Roger, you should start. You-
start with that.
I have to start and to stop because, of course, first it could be, it fit the history narrated by Peter and Zachary when there is a return by Shakespeare to collaboration, because it's one of the three plays written with Fletcher, and we can suppose in the order Cardenio, perhaps All Is True, Henry VIII, and the Two Noble Kinsmen, and there is an homology of the plot between Cardenio and the Two Noble Kinsmen. So, in this sense, Cardenio is into this collaborative Shakespeare. Cardenio is fitting also in the history of the knowledge by English playwrights, included Shakespeare, but still more Fletcher, of the Spanish literature, romances, novels, comedias themselves. So it could be one of these links between the golden age spent abroad and this appropriation by English playwright. For coming back to the portrait, there are two or three things to say. First, that the first portrait by Cervantes was an autoportrait, but by ekphrasis, that is to say by word. In the prologue of the Novelas Ejemplares in 1613, he said his ambition was to have on the title page, as it is a custom now. But he is disappointed. There is no portrait of him. Yeah. So he starts to write by the word, to paint by the word the portrait, which could be connected also with the idea of the semantic equivalence between to paint or to draw and to write and to read. So this is the first portrait by Cervantes. It's a portrait by words in the prologue of 1613. After the double or three portraits of Cervantes as Don Quixote, Cervantes as the author, and Cervantes in an Hercules, which is going to the Parnassus and which is defending the muses against the bad poets. And here it's a very subtle play with one of the books by Cervantes, El Viaje del Parnasso. There is an edition, an Italian edition, some years after the first one, in which the plot is that Cervantes is encountering, meeting Mercury, and Mercury wants Cervantes mobilizing the very true poets against the bad poets, which are spoiling the Apollo. And so the story, which is thousands of lines of verse, is this mobilization. And finally, there is a kind of poetomachia, between the bad and the good poet. The engraver has displaced, because here it's the fact that as an Hercules with this nude is entering into the Parnassus, not against the bad poet, but against the chivalric novel. And what is interesting in the chivalric novel and their extravagant invention, close to the Parnassus, you have a monster with three heads, you have dragons. And so what is interesting, it's connected to what Peter said, that is to say, on the one hand, the fact that there is a canonization, in a sense, of Cervantes as a poet. And a poet who will receive a mask, and the mask of Don Quixote. And it is necessary for this admirable poet to take the mask of the satire for denouncing the bad literature, the chivalric fantasies, and to restore the legitimacy of the muses. So it's not an illustration of the Viaje del Parnasso, but it's a reference to the Viaje del Parnasso. And last point about this connection between Shakespeare and Cervantes, listening to Peter, I think there was at least two. One could be, evidently not between the two authors, but between for their history, the Thompson, of these beautiful four volumes, Don Quixote La Mancha, is the brother, I think, of son and father, I don't remember, Thompson, who was the editor of the works by Shakespeare, The Row and after Pope. Mm-hmm. And so there are another I like this. It's the exemplary novel that Peter has shown. You have the name of the translator, which is Diego Puelleser, which is a translation of the name of Just Maybe. To whom is attributed the fourth of the poem, the dedicatory poem in the first folio. Yeah. So it would be another link between between the two.
Well, just I think we have to.
Okay. I should say something to my
Thank you, Roger.